amazing accomplishments. So I'm a writer, a translator, and an editor. And if you bribe me, I can do words for you. I have also recently mastered literature by writing a thesis on narrative structures in nonlinear video games, which is coincidentally also the topic of my talk today. Who would have thought? And I am not a pirate anymore. I have left those things behind me. And I also play the ukulele, just like our jingle girl. Maybe we can jam sometime. So, let's get to it. How do games tell stories? So, there's many different ways. The most common one is just a linear storytelling. Like any book or movie that you've ever read or seen, you have a story that just goes through. And then there's nonlinear storytelling, which is usually branching, where you choose option A, B, or C, and then decide how the story continues. And then there's also open world structures, where you usually have to fulfill quests or missions, and generated from gameplay, where there's no actual story, but like games such as The Sims or Civilization just have stories that happen to you as you play. And then there's also games that have no narrative, or at least no intended narrative, like Tetris or Minesweeper. You can argue about that, but like usually any narrative that you get from that is something that you interpret. And the extremely special thing about games is the role of the player. So the player is not just the reader or the recipient, as we call them in literary theory, where the recipient is very passive. You just get a story served to you. But as the player of a video game, you virtually control the protagonist's body through the means of an avatar. And I will get to more detail about what that means later. And also, if you're in a non-linear game, you make certain choices about how the story progresses, and that makes you a co-author of the title. So, this also brings us to the very first problem that we have with storytelling in games, which is called the interactive paradox. And that means that on one hand, the author seeks control over the direction of the narrative in order to give it a satisfactory structure. On the other hand, a participating user demands the autonomy to act and react without authorial constraint. So there's basically this war happening between the writer and the player, who both want to wrestle for control. And the way that most games deal with this problem is by separating story and gameplay. So basically, you have your levels that you play and where you score points and do all the gamey things, and then you have the story parts, which are usually cutscenes or scripted scenes. And what happens in those scenes is that the control is taken away from the player. So you're just passive, again, like a recipient. So many players like to skip those cutscenes. Other players basically play to unlock the story. It's a matter of personal preference. What is interesting to me is what happens when the story is the gameplay. When there's games such as, you know, Life is Strange or The Standing Parable, which I wrote my thesis about, where the story is the point of the game. So in order to look at that, let's ask first, what makes you care about a story? What is the thing that, you know, makes you engaged and immersed and want to know more? So, very first thing is the plot. Just the matter of what is happening. And then there's the timing and the suspense. Like the matter of when is it going to happen. And then, last but not least, is the emotional immersion and empathy. Like, who is this happening to? And how do I feel about this? And let's start with the plot. So usually in Western storytelling, you have a pyramid or a narrative arc where there's like exposition, rising action, climax, falling action, and conclusion. And you're very, very used to this format of storytelling. In games, like you see on the left hand, there's a decision tree where each choice should theoretically lead to another one, and sometimes they interlock, but basically you have like a tree. In reality, that's a lot of writing that people usually don't get done. So in reality, it looks more like the thing on the left. Anyway, where it loops back and choices melt into each other. And it's basically impossible to create a satisfying Aristotelian story arc for every single one of the branches. So what's the solution to this problem? I don't have one. It's kind of a balancing act. So Life is Strange, for instance, just loops back to two possible endings of all of your choices. And they said that the frustration that the player feels at this is part of the message of the game, which, you know, if you buy that. While the Stanley Parable approached this problem by making the limits of choice the topic of the game. Because the player cannot make truly individual choices because they all have to be pre-written and pre-programmed in order for that path even to exist. So any choice is an illusion anyway. That got very meta very fast. So let's move on to the next thing, which is time. So time in general is a very difficult factor in games, because it is inherently player-oriented. There's a big difference between narrative time and player time, because narrative has like a certain story that it wants to tell, but the player needs time to fulfill all the different quests and look for objects and search for every single bin in this like level or anything. So how do you solve this problem? And usually what happens is that the narrative time is suspended. So for example, if you have a dialogue, the interface will be displayed and the game will not continue with its narrative until you have made a choice. So narrative time is suspended for the gameplay. And this sort of causes a dissonance between the time as it's narrated. For example, you're in Skyrim and some non-player character tells you, oh my god, this dragon's gonna kill us all if you don't go to this town immediately. But then you just like go through the entire world, and then at some point when you feel like you arrive at that town, and then it just happens to be like a dragon attack right now. So yeah, there's a dissonance. The question is also, how does this affect suspense? So suspense is really critical for enjoyment of any story. And the German narratologist Manfred Pfister defined conditions of suspense this way. Like, the recipient can only have partial information about the future, and the recipient needs to have, the characters have to be in some kind of danger, there has to be a risk, and the recipient has to identify with the main character. So let's talk about these a little more in depth. The partial information is necessary because the recipient needs to make hypotheses. Like, if you're reading a story or watching a movie or playing a game, you want to know what happens next, and you have to have some theories about what that could be, and also about what could go wrong. So he calls these anticipating hypotheses. And that is completely achievable for games. They can just use normal means of storytelling, like foreshadowing and like gradually revealing information. But you also, as the player, know a bit more than you would as just like a passive viewer, because you know if you're gonna choose option A, B, or C. But that does not mean that you're gonna know what happens once you choose that. The second factor is risk. And this is something that games excel at entirely. Because there's not only like the narrative risk, there's not only the chance for the character to die, they can die at your hands, potentially. There's the potential of gameplay or ludic failure. So you could lose a fight, you could fall off a platform, or you could have just like a game over situation. A great example for this is the game Heavy Rain, where where there's a scene where you have to drive a car into oncoming traffic and your character would die. And I played that and I had to pause it every 30 seconds because the adrenaline rush would get too much. So yeah, this shows that narrative suspense can be really greatly enhanced by gameplay. And the last thing is that the recipient has to identify with the main character. And as I mentioned before already, this is super easy for games as well because you virtually control their bodies. So the identity is already kind of a given because you see the entire world through their perspective. And this is where I really segue to the next part of the presentation, which means that this sort of like identification is not just physical, you also can experience their emotional state. So because you are seeing the world or the game world through somebody else's eyes, this somebody else can be somebody who's very, very different from you. So an example for this is Hellblade, Senua's Sacrifice, where you play a character who's suffering from psychosis. So you're hearing voices all the time, like the same voices that your main character is hearing, and it's very annoying, and that's the point of it. So yeah, there's all these like different possibilities to feel empathy in games. And in general, like the way to make you relate to any sort of stories is write characters that are well-rounded, that are complex, that are interesting, that are flawed. Just like all the things you like in any sort of story. And the great thing is in games you can interact with them. And that is also the biggest problem. Because if you can approach the characters, they will inevitably fall flat of that interaction. Because there's not enough computing power, there's not enough writing to create a truly dynamic response to every player interaction. So usually what happens is that non-player characters have, if you can just approach them at will, they have one or two sentences that they repeat over and over again, or they fall silent, or yeah, they just disappear. So, sorry, I need to get rid of some paper. And in books and movies, you can accept minor characters that don't have any speaking roles or much background because you cannot approach them. So, this is the very problem with player characters in games, not player characters. That doesn't mean that there aren't really great characters in games. I'm sure all of you can think of like tons of video game characters that you hated or loved or mourned because they always die, because you fail to protect them. And that's the next point. You are very much responsible for the interaction with the other characters and often also responsible for their survival and well-being. And the more you care about the other character, the more of a feeling of personal responsibility will result. Another great example is Papers, Please, where you are a border patrol worker in a dictatorship and you have to make morally ambiguous choices in order to protect your family. So yeah, a sense of responsibility is very, very important for empathy games. I would even go one step further and say that games can access emotional states that are completely unavailable to other media. And I first heard this from a woman called Catherine Isbister. She gave a talk here about 2 years ago. She's the author of the book How Games Move Us, Emotion by Design. And she mentioned the case of Will Wright, who is the creator of The Sims. And he was talking about an instance when he was playing the game Black and White. And in this game, you can create this creature, and depending on how you treat it, you can make it good or evil. And he just wanted to see what happens if he mistreated the creature. So he slapped it. And immediately he started to feel super guilty. And he was very surprised by that because he knew that this wasn't real, but still he felt personally responsible and guilty. And this capacity to evoke actual feelings of guilt from a fictional experience is unique to games. Like in other media, you can feel maybe a sense of collusion, you can feel sorry, you can feel joy, but you cannot feel personal triumph or guilt at the protagonist's action. So, I am actually at my conclusion. So, what I would like you to take away from this talk, if you have taken in all this information, is that video games have are facing a lot of challenges when it comes to plot and structure, and narrative time is at odds with fluidic time, or with gameplay time. But suspense can be greatly enhanced by gameplay, and games have the unique ability to generate empathy through a sense of personal responsibility, and games can also achieve emotional states that other media can't. Thank you very much.